The User Datagram Protocol is another widely used Layer 4 protocol, and because it is so widely used, there are, of course, going to be many UDP-based attacks. So again, as a security analyst, you have to know what normal UDP datagrams look like, how UDP should function, and by doing so, you'll be able to recognize an abnormal datagram that could have a hidden threat contained in it. We also need to understand the difference between TCP and UDP, and the reason for this is so that you're able to distinguish TCP activity versus UDP activity. Now, as far as UDP characteristics go, UDP does, of course, operate at layer 4 of the OSI model, and so it is operating at the same layer as TCP, but its functionality differs. So where TCP was providing us with connection-oriented services, UDP provides us with what we would consider connectionless. It is a one-way datagram. It doesn't establish a full duplex mode of communication. Now, UDP does use IP protocol number 17. So if we were to go down a layer and we were to look at an IP header, the protocol field would point to protocol 17. Now, the reason that we like UDP is because it provides us efficient access to the network layer without that overhead that we would see with TCP. So we don't have the reliability, we don't need the reliability mechanisms. UDP is all about efficient access to that network layer. Now again, it's a connectionless protocol, it's a one-way datagram. There's no notification that it made it to the destination. But that's okay, because what happens is the upper layer, the application that's using UDP, will let us know if we received the information or not. Now UDP is sort of limited in its error checking capability. It does have an optional checksum value. That's optional in IP version 4, but it's been made a requirement in IP version 6. Now, in addition to its limited error checking, you should know that UDP is sent on the best effort basis. So no guarantees of data delivery. Packets could be corrupted in transit. They could be misdirected in transit. They could be lost along the way. UDP doesn't have any special features that'll recover from that if it were to happen. So for all of that, we're going to rely on the upper layer application to handle any error correction and detection and retransmissions. UDP doesn't do that for us. Again, UDP is all about giving us fast, efficient access to the network layer. So if we were going to provide you with an analogy, it would be very similar to using the postal service to send a letter versus a carrier service to send something certified. If a carrier service sends it certified, you get a notification that it's been delivered. That's just like TCP. However, with UDP, once you put a stamp on the envelope, address it, and put it into the mailbox, it's up to the postal service to deliver it, and we don't know if it's going to get there or not. The only way we know is if the application, so in this analogy, it would be the person receiving the mail, lets us know that they received it. Now, what kind of applications would use UDP? Well, there's actually a number of applications. One application that is often used in data networking is TFTP. This is the Trivial File Transfer Protocol, and it's a very simple transfer protocol. It is used to copy operating systems. We used to use this a lot with our Cisco routers. So our Cisco router could act like a TFTP server, and we could copy files to it. It could also act as a TFTP client, and we could copy files back and forth in that manner. We could copy an image to the device or off of the device to back it up. So TFTP as an application itself is not as bulky as the file transfer protocol, or FTP. FTP does authentication, TFTP doesn't. TFTP does its own error checking and sequence numbering. It doesn't need the reliability of the transport layer, so therefore UDP is a perfect fit. Now, when it comes to SNMP, that's another protocol that uses UDP, or another application that uses UDP. Now, SNMP is a simple network management protocol. This is a protocol that's used to monitor and manage our network devices. So SNMP sends protocol data units, or PDUs, that let me monitor and control network devices. Again, UDP is a perfect fit for this because SNMP will handle the error checking and sequencing and so on. Another protocol is DNS, the domain name system. This resolves our IP addresses from human readable names. So for example, www.cisco.com has an IP address associated with it. When we type in cisco.com and hit enter in our web browser, we're going to use the DNS application in the background to figure out what the IP address is of cisco.com so that we can actually send it to the right place. So DNS can use either TCP or UDP. When we do name resolution, it uses UDP in most cases. That's faster than TCP. Again, it's faster because we don't have to establish a three-way handshake. We don't have to worry about all of the reliability mechanisms that are built into TCP. But if we have messages where the size is going to be bigger than the DNS protocol's limit, and we're going to need reliable service, then DNS can use TCP. Another protocol that we have that uses UDP is the network time protocol. This simple protocol synchronizes time from a server that's out on the internet or some other source. It could be a router that you've deemed to be the NTP server. So again, this is a protocol that does not need to be reliable, so UDP is a perfect fit. All right, so that's just an example of four different applications that use UDP. Let's take a look at the UDP header. The UDP header is much more lightweight and streamlined than a TCP header would be, and that's simply because we don't have all those reliability mechanisms. All we need is that 16-bit source port, 16-bit destination port, the length, our checksum, and then it'll be followed by the application data. Again, it's good to understand this UDP header, the format. Most attacks against UDP are going to be using these fields in a way that UDP was not intended to be used, or they're going to be trying to hide themselves covertly in UDP packets.